It's very difficult to give a lecture after post-lunch period. At the outset, I must thank the office bearers of Amox and Amaravati Society and Dr. Nandita Pashetkar for giving me this opportunity. Beautiful place, beautiful food, very good hospitality. My topic today given is asymptomatic endometrial thickening or hyperplasia. The other day I was consulting, I saw a file, a patient. Her hysterectomy was done at the age of 35. I opened the file. The only abnormal finding I saw, her ultrasonography report, TVS done, with thickened endometrium. So, what is endometrial hyperplasia? What is endometrial thickening? It is defined as endometrium of more than 5 millimeter discovered on ultrasonography. As per the current ultrasonic literature suggests that asymptomatic endometrial thickness of 8 to 11 millimeter in a postmenopausal woman is also not abnormal. The endometrium may normally be thicker in the first year after last menstrual period, that is in a initial postmenopausal period, due to some residual hormonal activity. The incidence of endometrial thickening in postmenopausal women ranges from 3 to 17%. The American Cancer Society does not recommend routine screening of asymptomatic patients for endometrial cancer. Now, we accidentally come in contact with this finding ultrasonographically when patient comes and presents with some other symptoms like pain in abdomen or some other symptoms where they are subjected to pelvic ultrasonography. There are different types of endometrial hyperplasia: simple hyperplasia without atypia, complex hyperplasia without atypia, and complex hyperplasia with atypia. As per the WHO hyperplasia classification, there are various types, and the percentage of simple hyperplasia is 53%, quite high. Very rarely in young patients where there are no other factors like obesity or hypertension or age, you find malignant changes in endometrial hyperplasia. So the Canadian Cancer Society reports that there is inadequate evidence that screening of ultrasonography or endometrial sampling would reduce the mortality with endometrial cancer. So routinely, if you see any endometrial hyperplasia, it doesn't warrant any. There are various studies which I will show you, which alarm you or which directs you towards endometrial sampling or biopsy or fractional DNC. The clinician also must consider the risk factor for endometrial cancer, including obesity, polycystic ovarian syndrome history, and diabetes mellitus, and of course the age. So if you find in any patient with this particular history, or on examination you find something, then you must subject them to further investigation if they happen to be on incidental endometrial thickening at any age. Again, the age factor is extremely important. If the patient is little elderly, comes as an incidental finding of endometrial thickening, you have to be careful. Now, what are the factors which you must consider? Obesity, diabetes mellitus history, history of PCOS, long phase of life with menstrual bleeding, nulliparity, history of infertility for a long time, history of breast cancer, patient on tamoxifen therapy, and high estrogen concentrations. So any factor which gives chance of malignancy in endometrium and you find endometrial thickness, you need to be little careful. Now, endometrial cancer is one of the most common malignancy in gynec. The incidence in Canada, when the study was done, was 19 per 1 lakh women. Approximately 80% of the endometrial cancer occur in postmenopausal women. 90% of women with endometrial cancer present with bleeding. And most women have stage 1 cancer when diagnosis is made. So many endometrial hyperplasias, if they come with bleeding, you have to be careful, especially if the patient is aged or with all this history of diabetes, hypertension, obesity, and so on and so forth. And you need to investigate or observe them for likelihood of malignancy of endometrium. Again, patient on tamoxifen, they also have, because of tamoxifen, endometrial hypoplasia. So they also don't warrant endometrial biopsy or aspiration or endometrial study, but you need to be careful and you have to observe them. For any woman presenting with postmenopausal bleeding, there is approximately 10% risk of endometrial carcinoma. So any asymptomatic endometrial hypoplasia or thickening, you need to only observe. And both American as far as Canadian OBGYN society, they have given guidelines not to further investigate them or subject them to hysteroscopy or DNC unless there are other factors. It is also unknown how many women who have endometrial cancer are diagnosed in the absence of bleeding. In 1981, Cross et al. initiated a screening study of 1,280 asymptomatic women aged 45 and older by endometrial sampling in New York, and carcinoma was found only in 0.6% cases, that is 6 out of 1,000. For that, they had to subject so many women that investigation. What is the significance of asymptomatic endometrial thickening? There is no definite that after so many millimeters you call it endometrial thickening. Various people have given various parameters, like some people say 4.5, some people say 5 millimeter, some say 8 millimeter. In the first year after the last menstrual period, normal endometrium is often thicker, as I said, because of the residual hormonal levels. After menopause, endometrial thickening may reflect proliferative endometrium or cystic endometrium or hyperplasia or complex hyperplasia or atypical hyperplasia, or in rare cases CA if other factors are responsible. So ultrasonography technology, by identifying vascular flow, now allows differentiation of polyps from other abnormalities in cases if there is an endometrial thickening. You need to rule out polyposis or multiple polyps. Increased vascularity and fluid accumulation in association with endometrial thickening are causes for greater concern than other findings. The screening studies of asymptomatic women, the various screening studies have been done, and unnecessary screening studies can subject patients for unnecessary diagnosis and unnecessary operative treatments, maybe hysterectomies also. The purpose of performing ultrasound in non-bleeding postmenopausal women, as I said earlier, may be for some other reason and you find this thickening as an incidental finding. So most cases of endometrial cancer are diagnosed as a result of symptoms reported by the patient, and they are rarely found if the patients are asymptomatic and only incidental finding of endometrial thickness is present. There are various studies done, and they calculated a 6.7% risk of endometrial cancer in when endometrium was again more than 11 millimeters. So again, the size of the endometrium is also important. Till 8 to 11, it was not that dangerous, they found out in this study. And after 11 millimeter of thickness, the incidence dramatically increased in CA endometrium, especially when patients had predisposing factors like obesity, hypertension, and other things. And there was a symptomatic, some spotting or some bleeding somewhere. So asymptomatic women without symptoms had no prognostic advantage over the symptomatic woman if bleeding had occurred for less than 8 weeks during a postmenopausal bleeding was correlated with the increasing tumor size. If there is a mass or if there is a polyp, then you have to be a little careful. And again, the size of the polyp is very, very important. So a review of literature, therefore, does not indicate that routine screening, that is transvaginal ultrasonography for endometrial cancer, is recommended. So there is no way of you should not subject your patients for all patients above certain age for routine TVS. Hypertension. Woman taking anti-hypertensive medicines or a known hypertensive patient, you have to be careful because they have this predisposing factor for CA endometrium. So any patient with a history of hypertension or obesity and a symptomatic thickening of the endometrium, you need to be careful. Patients who are on hormone replacement therapy, again, you have to be careful. There was a study and with TVS and histological findings in endometrial evaluation of postmenopausal women using HHT to evaluate safety of hormonal therapy, and there is a small chance. So even if they're asymptomatic, you have to be careful and you have to watch them. Patients with asymptomatic endometrial thickness with endometrial polyps, hysteroscopic resection of both symptomatic and asymptomatic polyps should be performed, since natural cause of malignant polyp is still unknown. Not all polyps have a tendency to undergo, but if the polyp is very big, there are multiple polyps, and if they are giving symptoms, they definitely need hysteroscopic evaluation and DNC or polypectomy if the polyp is very big. So there are various studies they have done for hyperplastic endometrium who are asymptomatic but having multiple polyps. And women over 60 with postmenopausal bleeding were 5.31 times more likely than asymptomatic younger women to have malignant polyps. So if any polyps in an elderly patient, any polyps with again history of hypertension, diabetes, history of PCOS and advanced age, you need to investigate them properly. A big polyp has to be investigated because there is always a chance of malignancy in them. Patients with tamoxifen, there are various studies done, and women taking tamoxifen have a greater risk of endometrial CA. This risk is augmented further if women are taking previously estrogen replacement therapy. So any patient taking tamoxifen, you need to keep a watch on them, and if there is an asymptomatic thickening, just keep a watch, otherwise you need to do aspiration or endometrial biopsy, DNC. Since the time is short, I need to. There are various types of complications we encountered where patients are subjected to unnecessary investigations like hysteroscopy and DNC or endometrial aspirations. Chances of perforation are there, chances of endometritis, infection are there, and so on and so forth. So in conclusion, the disease is usually diagnosed at an early stage when postmenopausal women, they present with the bleeding. And asymptomatic endometrial thickening should only be observed unless the patient is very old, having history of diabetes, hypertension, or history of PCOS. Then there are various recommendations. Transvaginal ultrasonography should not be used as screening for endometrial CA. Severe. Endometrial sampling in a postmenopausal woman without bleeding should not be routinely performed. Indications for tissue sampling of the endometrium in bleeding postmenopausal women with an endometrial thickness of greater than 5 millimeters should not be explored, extrapolated to asymptomatic women. A woman who has endometrial thickening and other positive findings on ultrasound, such as increased vascularity, inhomogeneity of endometrium, and thickening of endometrium more than 11 millimeters should be investigated. Decision should further be about further investigation should be made on a case-to-case basis. In asymptomatic women on tamoxifen, you have to observe them or investigate them if they fall in a particular risk group. And not all postmenopausal women who have asymptomatic endometrial polyps require surgery. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.